In theory, you take a DAG and you schedule it on a PRAM. But here's a question. Where do DAGs come from? The answer is from you. But you need a programming model to generate the DAGs. Let me show you one that I think is especially clean and elegant. Here's the DAG for a divide-and-conquer algorithm to compute a reduction. You've argued that it's work optimal and it has logarithmic span. Now, I want to give you an algorithm that produces this DAG. Let's start with just a sequential algorithm that implements the divide-and-conquer scheme. So here's the pseudocode for such an algorithm. It takes an array A of length n, and if there are at least two elements, it does divide-and-conquer, so recursively calls itself on each half of the array and returns the sum. Otherwise, the array is just of size 1, and it returns that element. Now, what you can observe is that the two recursive calls are independent of one another. Now, since the two recursive function calls are independent, I'm going to give you a special keyword to mark that fact. That keyword is called spawn. The target of a spawn is always either a function call or a procedure call. In this case, I'm showing a function call. Now, the spawn keyword is a signal to either the compiler or the runtime system that the target is an independent unit of work. By inserting the spawn, you're effectively saying that the target may be executed asynchronously from the caller anytime a processor is available. Now, even though these two calls are independent units of work, notice that they produce intermediate results that then have to be combined. In other words, there's a dependence from A and B and the return statement. That means in addition to spawns, we also need a way to indicate these kinds of dependences. For that, I'll give you a second special keyword called sink. So one question, to which spawns does a given sink apply? So we will use a particular convention, which is that the sink waits for any spawn that has occurred so far within the same stack frame. If you need a refresher on call stacks and stack frames, please see the instructor's notes. Let me make one final remark about spawn and sink. Now, suppose you leave the sink out. Even if you leave sink out, there will always be an implicit sink at the return immediately before going back to the caller. Let me show you what that means by transforming this code to match the note. So instead of return of A plus B, we'll generate three statements. The first will evaluate the operand A plus B. The second will perform the sink. And then finally, we'll return the value to the caller. And notice where the sink appears. And you transform the other return in the same way. Now, an important point. Even with this transformation, the program is still wrong. Can you see why? Notice that the sink appears after the sum. Now, the two spawned calls are only guaranteed to be complete at the sink. Therefore, the values of A and B might not yet be valid at that point. Now, the fact of implicit sinks will constrain the kinds of DAGs that this programming model can produce. The style of parallelism in such DAGs is sometimes called nested parallelism. Now, once you see how this pseudocode gives rise to a DAG, you'll understand where the term nested parallelism comes from. Let's go back to the correct code. Now, what I want you to do is to try simulating the algorithm to see how the DAG unfolds. So in particular, let's say we start to execute a reduce on an array of size 4. The first step is to enter the reduce call. And that creates the first unit of work within the DAG. Then there's the conditional test. Then you encounter the spawn. Here's where things get interesting. The spawn creates a new branch in the DAG. Essentially, the spawn signals that there is a new independent of work that's ready to go, and it creates a new path as well. Now, in the meantime, the current path will continue. So this is an extremely important point that the spawn creates essentially two independent paths. One path carries the new work, and the other path is the path that continues executing immediately after the spawn. Now, while the main path is happily going about its business, the newly spawned path is a recursive call, and therefore it has to generate its own subgraph. Now, you are traveling along the main path, and so you'll encounter the second spawn. This branching will happen again. Next, you'll reach the sink. The sink waits for the previous spawns to complete. In terms of the DAG, that should create some dependence edges between these subgraphs and the sink point. Control then goes to the return statement, and you'll evaluate A plus B, and then finally return that value.